because another morning praise is upon God. Us.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
And thank you for the coffee that everyone has this morning.
Well, we're asking for an infilling of the living water.
Yes.
This
yes.
morning, that cool, refreshing outpouring from your throne this morning, Father.
Yes, Lord God.
Thank you, Lord. We come to celebrate Jesus this morning. Lift up the name of our God. You're worthy, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here today. Welcome in this place, in our homes, in our lives. Hallelujah. So just so y'all know, I'm singing with half-frozen mouth. I had two teeth removed.
It was a dentist day, Branches.
So
stretch forth your hands to
Yeah, I'm doing fine. I survived.
She is. She's
Hallelujah. So
she's singing praises to the Lord. That's very perfect.
Hey, frozen or not frozen, my heart is warmed by the Spirit.
Frozen
of
or not frozen, we are about our Father's business.
Amen. So let's sing. We will dance. Glory to God.
His glorious word, and go, we will look on his face. We'll go to a much better place. Oh,
out of the land. We'll join. We'll join in the song of the land. Oh, say now the time of rejoicing is here.
Walking in the streets of heaven and dancing with our groom. This is a beautiful song.
Hallelujah. I'm going to attempt to drink water and not spit.
Okay. Pay attention, branches. No, no aftermath there.
Nope. It worked.
You should have seen the fountain earlier.
Trying to drink with a frozen mouth.
Amen.
Anyways. Your name, Lord. Yeah.
Praise the Lord, man.
Praise the Lord. Thereby.
That is so different than what's happening in our house right now, because it's blowing snow. It's minus 8 out.
Yeah, yeah.
We're having, like, a week and a half after the first day of spring, we're having a snowstorm.
No, I guess it comes in like a lion and it's going out
yeah,
like a lion.
As we were talking about this morning, here up north, it's not, March doesn't come in like a lamb and go, or come in like a lion and go out like a lamb. It comes in like a lion and it goes out like a lion.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, man.
And it leaves its doo. Do, do. Do.
A do, 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 and a da, da, da. Hallelujah. Well, let's go into the Word of God.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your precious Word. Hallelujah. Lord, fill us with truth today.
Yes, Lord.
The truth of your Word.
Yes, Lord.
May it inspire us. May it encourage us today as we study, Lord, and learn of you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Hello.
We're back.
Praise God.
What? And with her teeth and all.
I am fine.
Her two left. Her left two left. Two
fine. Praise the Lord.
Praise
God
the
is
Lord.
Good.
Praise the Lord. And all the time.
Didn't take them long to do it all.
Amen. Amen. So where were we yesterday when we were interrupted by your dentist appointment?
The 19th? I mean...
No, your dentist appointment was on the 29th, not the 19th.
The 29th, yeah. We're on the 19th verse.
Of?
Isaiah chapter 8.
Just seeing if she was paying attention, Branches.
Of course I'm paying attention.
And seeing if you're paying attention, because I can... I've been in the
chat.
Well,
yeah, with all
not.
The chatting going on, praise the
not.
Lord. I know y'all.
You're listening. I get it. Yeah, and you'll go back and listen. And I wouldn't have it any other way. I wouldn't have it any other way. So we're all aware of the. Actually, we kind of left off, and you know, I've said before that sometimes the way the Bible has been arranged in the last 300 years with the introduction of chapters and verses. That sometimes chapter divisions and chapter verses are put in an inconvenient or even in a wrong place. And it can be put in the middle of a thought or in the middle of a speech. It's just, let's put it this way. The scriptures are inspired, but the chapters and the verses and the way they're arranged is not. It is not. It's helpful. It's very helpful for us always studying the Bible, but it is not inspired by any sense of the word. And those that developed the system would tell you it's not inspired.
Right.
So,
because originally it was like all on one big scroll.
Yeah. Right?
Yeah, one big scroll.
Divisions. And we mentioned that too, especially in when the Lord Jesus went into the synagogue in Nazareth, and he said, they asked him to come up and read the scriptures in Isaiah, and he said he found the place where the verse that he wanted, which we know as Isaiah 61, but he had to unroll and look and see exactly in all these lines of written texts exactly where this particular passage began. So, and that's why it uses that particular phrase in the Gospels when it says he went and found the place where it was written. And so in our case, we are this is God's last, well, I shouldn't say that, because he continues, this is going to go into chapter 9, which, and chapter 9 of course is another one of these very very important chapter in this small book of Emmanuel. Remember I told you from chapter 7 to 12
right. Is
a book inside a book. And this is where we glean a lot of our passages for the coming of the Lord Jesus. But the Emmanuel passages, we looked at it in Isaiah 7. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and you shall call his name Emmanuel. And we're going to see it again in 9, where we actually... the one where we, for to us a child is born, and a son is given. And we're going to be getting more of that in chapter 9. This is going to be all part of this same
this speech, that Isaiah is giving, or this declaration that mm-hmm. Isaiah is giving to Ahaz and his counselors outside the walls of Jerusalem in the Fuller's Field. This is all part and parcel. It started in 7, going on through chapter 8, going in chapter 9. Mm-hmm. So it's quite a long speech, and we've been going piece by piece as we do. So we kind of left it in the middle of a thought here, in that Isaiah was saying about writing the testimony mm-hmm. and sealing it and making it a legal document about the prophecy that God is going to remove the thing that they fear the most at that point, which is the kingdom of Israel and Syria. And so, and again, here is where we get many times, and this is what we don't like as human beings. And I think it's just because this is one of those things that we feel the brevity of life. We do not like to wait for things. You know, we have this saying that life is too short to be doing this, doing that, doing this. And we're looking into that. And Isaiah is saying, he said, I will wait for the Lord. Okay. Mm-hmm. Those of us, and that's all of you, those of us who put their trust and their faith in the Lord, if we didn't know before, we are taught in our walk of faith how to wait upon the Lord. You know, we pray for a lot of things, and we expect, and the thought is always in our head how we want God to answer our prayer or answer our, like Ann says, answer any questions we might have. And or asking God, why are you doing this, as Habakkuk did. And we looked into that, you know, and he said, mm-hmm.
Pastor Bob spoke on Monday.
We said, and the whole idea of the write the vision on the tablets, and if it should tarry, wait for it. Okay. And this,
wait for it.
And this is the problem Israel had. They didn't wait for it, not in the wilderness, not in the time of the judges.
They're impatient because they wanted what they wanted now.
But should you think, and that's right,
but
should you think that that's just a failing of Israel, that's a failing of all of us,
of
all human beings.
We live in a land of instant everything.
It's worse drive-throughs, for us.
Drive-throughs, microwaves,
Exactly. It's even worse for
us. And it just, it contributes to the impatience. You know, people don't know how to wait.
No, they don't.
And you know, Isaiah 40:31 says, but they that wait upon the Lord
shall
renew
their strength. They shall mount up on wings
like eagles. Yeah.
Right. And so it's probably one of the hardest things that we have to do as human beings. We need to wait. And I get
be patient. And that's fruit of the Spirit.
And be patient. And that's hard. Like Anne will tell you, I don't have a lot of patience, and a lot of us don't.
Because you're not a doctor.
That's true. And I don't work in a hospital. I don't have patience, but.
Well, you do. It just needs to be worked in you.
Yes.
And it sure was a few days ago.
and it is. And we were taught very early on, and I think this is true, never ask God for patience. You need to develop it yourself.
I did it for years.
You
he
need
gave
to
me
develop,
trouble.
Because if you get it, if you ask patience from God, you will.
I have a son for you.
You're in for a rough road. Not because he doesn't love you, but he's answering your prayer. I want patience. Well. You're going to have the patience of Job, as we like to say, proverbially. You know, everything that happened to Job when we looked in the book of Job, all the disasters that came upon him, he had to have patience. And in his way, he was waiting on the Lord. He was waiting on the Lord. We talked about it. He was waiting on the Lord to answer him.
Mm-hmm.
Answer the question, why, Lord? Why am I? Why am I being afflicted?
How many chapters?
And how long must I? You know, over 38 chapters, he's talking about the same. So here we have Isaiah telling Ahaz, wait, I will wait on the Lord. He's already given you a sign. The sign is not only Emmanuel, which is God with us, and and again, we said this, I kind of believe that this refers not necessarily to somebody called Emmanuel, but this is the purpose to which this child is going to be. He's going to be assigned to us. Mm-hmm. A sign to the people of Judah then, and the Lord's birth in Bethlehem, a sign to all of us that God is with us. And then he tells the king here, which is where we left off yesterday, he's with his, he, he says, my sons and I are here as proof that God has spoken, that I have spoken the word of God, because it has come about. Mahar Shalal Hashbaz is here. His first
name.
And his other son. His other son, Shir Jashub, the one he took to the Fuller's Field, who is with him even now. These, and we saw how all these names, the names of his sons, plus the name of Isaiah himself, have this great meaning to the king. This is proof. And Isaiah is telling the king, this is proof. My sons are proof that God will do what he said he's going to do. He said, therefore, I will wait on the Lord, because he's hiding his face.
He will wait or he will hope.
See, even though he's hiding his face from the house of Jacob.
It's the same thing.
Yeah. And obviously, I'm pretty sure that Ahaz was asking the priests in the temple, I need to hear from the Lord. I need to hear what's going on. And they weren't getting an answer. And because of all the idolatry in the world, and we talked, or in the land. And we talked about Ahaz's idolatry. And we talked about how he, like all the other evil kings, brought idolatry and mixed false worship with the true worship. Tactic of the enemy, right?
That mixture. Yep.
Tactic of the enemy. The lie is not effective unless it's mixed with the truth to make it palpable, to make it believable. And we're sort of getting the impression here from Isaiah, which is one of the reasons why he's coming out to speak to the king. Because the king isn't getting any answers, but he's getting it from Isaiah. And he said, my sons are proof of this. I've told you this is going to happen. You need to wait on the Lord and see that these things are. Do not try to force his hand by doing anything. And we talked to yesterday about how Ahaz's plan was probably to surrender to these and let them take everything that they possibly could, but leave them alone.
Remember the trouble that King Saul got in because he didn't wait?
Because he didn't wait.
He
didn't wait
on Samuel. He did sacrifice himself. And
he didn't wait. He didn't wait for Samuel to do this. That's right. And for the Amalekites.
And he lost it. Right there, he lost the kingship.
And of course, we always should remember in waiting that in that particular case, what did Samuel tell Saul? You know, that obedience is better than sacrifice. If he told you to wait for me and he told you to wait, then you wait. But after 7 days, he couldn't wait. And that's why I said there's another great example of how we as human beings cannot wait.
And he himself consulted a medium.
And he ended up consulting a medium, which we're going to be talking about here. And because, and that's where we left off. We left off in verse 18 with his children. Okay, so what we left off is what Isaiah was saying. This is the truth of it, Ahaz, your majesty. This is the truth. My sons and I stand here as proof that God is with you and God is speaking to you. And God is, regardless of your rebelliousness and the hatred that you have shown towards God in your attitudes of worship, God is still with you. Mm-hmm. And God is still going to move in your behalf. Just wait and be firm. And he will deliver you, because it is not his purpose that you should drown in the waters of Assyria at this point, so to speak.
Don't get involved with them.
And that's where we left off. But it's kind of it's kind of in the middle of this speech that Isaiah is giving. So he ends up with his son. So how does he continue with his speech? And he's going to make a comparison between what he has just told Isaiah and a comparison of what they are doing. And so we'll pick that up in verse 19, Eric, if you will.
And when they say to you, seek those who are mediums and wizards, who whisper and mutter, should not a people seek their God? Should they seek the dead on behalf of the living? To the law and to the testimony, if they do not speak according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. They will pass through it hard-pressed and hungry, and it shall happen, when they are hungry, that they will be enraged and curse their king and their God, and look upward. Then they will look to the earth and see trouble and darkness, gloom of anguish, and they will be driven into darkness.
Whoa.
And so Isaiah, now as prophets will always do, he's coming back, and the Lord is having him. Let's review your iniquities here, Judah. Mm-hmm. What are you doing? And it's just sometimes we don't understand, or we don't face the things that we're doing unless someone else points it out to us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's true.
And we need that sometimes.
And we do need that.
We do.
We definitely need that, because we can be stubborn. Mm-hmm. Even those of us.
Well, we have blind spots.
Believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, we can be stubborn.
Mm-hmm.
It's like what Dr. McGee used to say about Peter, James, and John. I mentioned this before, that we always think that they were the, you know, the inner circle of the Lord's, and they had all the special lamb. Dr. McGee said, the only reason that they got all this extra instruction was because they were the problem children. Then they need they were prideful. They wouldn't.
Jesus had to keep an eye on them, right?
Jesus had to keep them before he get them in trouble. Remember James and John, they're called the sons of thunder, and there's a reason why they're called the sons of thunder, because they went into a village to proclaim the Lord, and they didn't want anything to do with it. And they came back to Jesus and said, should we call down fire and lightning and destroy this village? And Jesus says, you don't know what spirit you're of. You know, you don't see any of the other disciples doing that. And of course, Peter, we all know Peter's bravado and just, you know.
No, he was impatient.
You know, Lord, if you say what you say is true, and you're going to Jerusalem, and you're going to be killed there, and you're going to be delivered to sinful men and going to be killed there, we're not going to let that happen. No, nope. I'm going to stand here. I'm going to pull my sword and
get behind me, Satan.
The Lord said, get behind me, Satan. You think as men think, not as God thinks.
Mm-hmm.
And of course,
can you imagine we say that to one another today?
But it's true. And Isaiah could have said the same thing to Ahaz. He says, this is your problem. You're not seeking the Lord. The Lord is telling you to seek him. The Lord is telling you that your life, your existence is dependent upon him.
Yeah.
I have named my children to show you
what
he is about to do in your midst as proof. God is giving you proofs, and not just in your reign, Ahaz, but through the whole history of our people, Judea, Jewish people. He has given us all sorts of signs and power, and yet you still choose to ignore it. But instead, what do? Instead of paying heed to the word of God, to the commands of God and the Torah, and remembering all the great deeds, like Psalms is full of those, telling the reader, remember the deeds of old, remember what the Lord has done amongst us. He said, but you've forgotten all those. You think that you can send, just like you making this alliance with Assyria to save you from Israel and Syria. Mm-hmm. Assyria, I said. He made an alliance with Assyria. It's a bit confusing, but I guess that's why he's called Aram. Syria is called Aram in this case. But he said, you're doing this, and this is your problem. Because it's your problem, it's all the people do this. And you're trying to do this in your own strength. You're trying to do this. You're doing it with your own understanding. You're relying on an arm of flesh. You're going to say something.
Well, yeah, they're involved in all kinds of witchcraft.
Necromancy. I was just going to and
the Canaanite gods, and
politically, you're making these alliances with nations, but spiritually, when you should be seeking me, you're trying to find out the future by going
to
these, and you know.
They seek the dead on behalf of the living. I mean, what doesn't make sense?
I'll put this, I can't think about it right at the moment, but I will put this up on the screen. There is a section in the Law of Moses that strictly prohibits the practice of magic, necromancy, of fortune telling, of seeking. Mm-hmm. Of seeking the future, of trying to inquire about the future using the black arts. They knew this. This was all part of their history, but it's part of the Law of Moses, and they chose to ignore it. They chose to do exactly what God told them not to do. But again, that's their history. That's their way. They've always ever done it that way, where they just just relying on what they can see, taste, feel, and touch in this world, rather than relying on the Lord. And God has to send Isaiah's and Jeremiah's and Amos's and Habakkuk's and Joel's and Micah's and Malachi's and all sorts of prophets before he actually sent his son. And think about what I just said in the context of the parable of the wicked vine dressers that Jesus told. That the prophets were the ones that came to get the harvest for the master, who the owner of the vineyard, and they were treated shamefully. Said they were beaten, they were killed. And then what did the master say? I'll send my son. He at least will respect. But they didn't. And they said, here is the son. Mm-hmm. Said, if we kill him, then we get the inheritance. We get the vineyard, which is Israel.
You know, that's so self-deceiving. How could they think that?
That's for the same.
Yeah, if they kill the son, you're right. Right?
But for the same reason, they go and look into necromancy and fortune telling, and
that's just rebellion against God.
And you know what? We think we're so sophisticated. There's a lot of people out there who want to read the horoscopes, go to fortune tellers. You know, they think it's all in fun, but there are some people that, palm reading and tea leaves and.
Yep, seances.
There are some people who just, they will do anything but turn to the Lord. They'll go and do all these things. And again, this is part and parcel of the idolatry of Ahaz's time, and it's part and parcel of the idolatry of our time. You know, we think we're so sophisticated. And yet, a lot of people wouldn't think twice about going to a fortune teller.
They turn to the wicked ones that don't even know God and revere him. Like,
And as Anne said, the problem with this, as later, it is because you have to deal. You're dealing with spirits. You're dealing with the spirit world, but you're dealing with spirits that are below, not above. You're not. You're not dealing with angelic beings when you pray to the Lord, and you're praying in the spirit. You know, your eyes are lifted up into the heavenly realms and where Jesus is seated and where he will one day have us seated with him. And that's what we look to. But many people, when they do that, you're looking to the dead. You're not looking to the living. You know.
Yeah.
And God is not a God of the dead, as Jesus said, but he's a God of the living. He's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Isaiah asked the question, can the living find the answers from the dead? Well, this is why the whole Witch of Endor is very, very mysterious and it is very difficult, because in a lot of ways, you know, you think about that story where Saul has the witch call up the spirit of Samuel. And we talked about this in the context of Sheol and how that works, the place of the dead. But what is it that Samuel said? Samuel prophesied to Saul as a spirit.
Samuel 28, as a dead spirit.
And he said, this day you and your sons will join me here in Sheol, which is exactly what happened. And so, but that's the only... And again, it is such a unique story. It is filled with mystery and why it's there, because it almost seems to contradict some of the things that
people get into debates about. Was it really
Samuel
or not Samuel?
And I don't want to get into it now, but it's just, this was a spiritual, a delving into this exactly spirit. What they were doing. Saul did the exact same thing that Ahaz is doing, or Ahaz did the same thing that Saul was doing. Now, of course, they were getting answers from the mediums and from the fortune tellers.
Who whisper and mutter. Like, they're not even saying words, they're muttering.
Muttering. Yeah. And that just adds to the mystery of it, right? Sure. You go into it, and it's always in darkness. If you've ever been to a fortune teller or anything, you know, in their house, in their parlors, or at the at a not a circus, but a fair, some fair, because there's your, no, you know, those fall fairs or summer fairs, where the, you know, not so much now, but in early times past. And there was always be a tent there for a fortune teller, and you could go in, and of course it was always dark.
There's tents there for Christian ministries that go in with their card readers.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, we like, saw like that. Like Bethel. We saw that.
You know, they went down to the convention, the witches' convention.
Yeah.
And they had their own booth.
And they had their own booth.
And they had cards.
Christian tarot, you know, reading.
Yeah.
That's an oxymoron if I ever heard one.
Very, very not right.
Exactly, and exactly what you were talking about here, mixing the true worship with false worship, with black magic.
Yeah.
You know, and you can't tell these people because they're so deceived. Like, are you kidding me? Don't call yourself Christian because you're not. You know, you obviously don't read the Bible.
Deceived in areas. Yeah.
And you know what the Bible says about these things.
Mm.
Anyway, and Isaiah asks, of course, he said, instead of doing this, why don't you just call on your God? Why don't you call on Yahweh? I've already told you he's doing these things. You've already seen the evidence of his hand moving amongst us. Ask him. Ask him on it. Don't go to these people. Don't go to the enemy. That's what he wants. Don't go into the shadows. Mm-hmm. Come out into the light and ask your questions. And God will answer. And God is answering you now, even though you're not asking. And I say that because, remember, God asked Ahaz to give him a sign, and Ahaz wouldn't.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, you know, we'll probably say a lot more about that, but.
You said God asked Ahaz to give him a sign.
It was a command.
Yeah, a command.
He asked him as a command to give him a sign.
Yeah.
You know, I say ask because it's in the.
Wasn't a suggestion.
It wasn't a suggestion.
No.
And so here's where. And here's where Isaiah says, he says, come and ask the Lord your questions. Why would you go to these people? He said, and then when you come to the Lord, and because you haven't come to the Lord because you refuse, he has sent me to you. And I've come to give you what he is saying. He said, now you know what the Lord is saying. And now you know what your witches and your necromancers and your magicians have told you. Compare them. Compare the two words. Compare them. Because, and then he says, because if their message is different from mine, it's because God did not send them.
There's no light.
Remember what we said about in Jeremiah 28, Jeremiah's dissertation on what makes a true prophet as opposed to a false prophet.
Every prophecy will come to pass.
And the true prophet will always be the watchman on the wall warning about the impending judgment that's coming that God is sending unless there's repentance. And that's what Jeremiah said. And all the prophets of old, that's what they did. They prophesied that. He said, the prophet who prophesies peace and good things like this, then the proof is in the pudding. Those things have to come to pass to see whether they are of God. And of course, in this time of judgment, both in this time and our time, those that say that, we know, those of us that sense in the spirit, that we are in this time of judgment, there's no way. There's no way you're living your best life now.
But I also noticed in the prophets that They give the judgment and they give the instruction of what needs to be done to change things and repentance and all this. And they give the, if you do this, this will happen.
Yeah.
Right? For good or for bad. Like, if you repent, this good thing is going to come to you and happen. In a lot of the prophecies. You know, there's always consequence.
But again, in this case, and that's true, hon, but in this case, as we've
not
been saying,
in this case,
they've gone past the mark. They've gone past the point of repentance here. Because as I say, in all these passages that we're dealing with in the 6th and 7th and 8th and going into the 9th chapter, mm-hmm. there's no mention of repentance here, right. that they can repent.
Yeah, I'm not saying that in light of this passage, but I'm saying prophecy also does that.
Yes, and I agree. Yeah. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And that's the reason for the prophets coming, so that people... Again, being
turn your
told,
life around so you can
prophets do what we said earlier, that they tell you things that you don't realize and maybe you don't see, mm-hmm. but God sees them. He sends a prophet. He says, you're doing this. Turn around before it's too late. Mm-hmm. You know,
they will pass through it hard-pressed.
Hard-pressed.
And hungry.
He said, but it's almost mm-hmm. like he's comparing. He said, okay, you've got your answer from your witches and your wisdom and your fortune tellers, and now you're going to get compare this to the word of God. And remember what God said to Isaiah in his calling. Remember we talked about this difficult ministry that Isaiah is going to have, that Isaiah is going to warn them, and that mm-hmm. Isaiah is going to speak to them,
they're
and he's going to tell them,
listen.
But they're not going to listen.
Fall on deaf ears.
He said, you're going to preach, yeah. and the more they hear it, the less they listen.
Mm-hmm.
And here's a good example of this. And this is why there's no sense of repentance. Turn to repentance, because if they're not going to listen about the judgment, if they're not going to believe in the judgment, they're not going to turn and repent. We can say it about our own time. All unsaved people there, when we stand up and we warn them and say, you know, we're in the time of Romans 1, and look yeah. around you, the things that are happening in the culture and the society,
yes.
we can see it so clearly. This is the Bible prophesied this. This mm-hmm. was going to happen. We need to repent as a nation. And of course, they'll just poo-poo you. No, we're mm-hmm. happy. We're happy with our status quo. We're happy with the sins that we're doing. We're happy about pushing all this stuff back in God's mm-hmm. face. And we don't believe He's the Creator. We don't believe that. No, we're very happy with our CNN and our Fox News and. Any kind of, on the internet, all sorts of either
faves,
business or political prophets who are out there talking mm-hmm. about, you know, whether the stock market's going to fall or whether there's going to be another assault on the Capitol if Trump gets in again and blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
All this stuff.
The latest thing that's happening at the UN.
And that's what they want to hear, stuff at the UN. And they want, again,
New World Order.
Again, we talk about conspiracy. We talked about yesterday mm-hmm. about God warning Ahaz. He said, don't say things are conspiracy and this and that. And don't be afraid of the things that they're afraid of. But, we might be Isaiah's. God's calling us to say these things. And I mean all of us. All of us is our witness. You know?
We're all called to prophesy Jesus.
We're all called to witness and prophesy of Jesus. But,
right.
you know, we know for the most part it falls on deaf ears. Although we do see, and the Lord is gracious because he allows us to see the small victories one at a time.
Amen.
Like Alan.
Yeah.
Like my daughter and mm-hmm. grandson, which was... talk about that at some point, but for the most part it seems that we're fighting not a losing battle, but we're not gaining any ground, but we really are, because our trust and faith is in God, just like Isaiah was telling them. Just trust in the Lord. Don't trust in these guys that are telling you all these great things. Lean not on your own understanding or their understanding for that matter.
Hmm.
He said, but you know, Isaiah's preaching the truth. It's very hard and difficult. And I pray that our society, our culture hasn't reached that point, the same point where God has made their ears so heavy that they won't listen. They'll come to a point of no return. They won't repent.
Well, the Word of God says that men will go to and fro looking for a word for the truth, and they won't find it.
Yeah.
You know, as well.
Yeah.
Because it's just going to be so dark out there.
And verse 21, mm-hmm. because of it, because of me. He says, my people will be led away captive, stumbling, weary, right. and hungry.
High-pressed
because and hungry. They've listened to the wrong voice. They won't listen to the voice of God. They're listening to the wrong voice, the voices that of the enemy. Yeah. And because of it, they are going to be led away captive.
Yeah, stumbling. They're going to be enraged. It says that they will be enraged and curse their king and their God and look upward, you know, and cursing God.
And what have we said about people in hell? We think that hell would, you know, sometimes we have an idea that hell is this place of repentance, that people will be full of regret and wringing their hands. If only I had done this. Well, no. You carry your rebellion into hell. If you shook your fist at heaven while you were in this plane of existence, you will shake your fist at God when you're in hell, when you're apart from God. Bemoaning your fate. It's sad. It's really sad.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but here we have it. You know, these people are still doing it. And they're doing it. They're doing it. And you're looking for something?
Yeah. I saw Exodus 22:28. It says, for that is his only covering. It is his garment. For his skin, what will he sleep in? And it shall be that when he cries to me, I will hear, for I am gracious. You shall not revile God, nor curse a ruler of your people.
So they're according to the law of Moses, here's another sin that they are committing, that they're cursing the ruler that has been put over them. Even though in 1 Samuel, that the law of Moses, I shouldn't say that because I know it says, and I'll find out where this is, but there's prophecy in the law of Moses that even though they didn't have a king until Saul, provisions for royalty, provisions for kingship, the ruling of a king over Israel was actually made in Deuteronomy, I'm sure, somewhere. He said, and when they ask for a king, when you ask for a king shall be this. He shall not be a keeper of horses. Things of that nature. I mean, that I can remember off the top of my head being, he shouldn't be acquisitive. He shouldn't be a miser. He is there to be a shepherd over his people and to serve them as their king. And it's this same understanding that we have of the Lord Jesus. That is the kind of king he is. He is a king who serves. You know, he's not a king who rules for his own sake, but he rules for the sake of others, the sake of those who are under his authority. Praise God. And aren't you glad of that, Francis?
Amen.
And
well, Jesus came to serve, not to be
served. The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And that's that aspect of kingship that is brought into the Messiah's kingship. Mm-hmm. Again, I'll look that up. It'll probably be a good topic. We have lots of good topics for discussion.
Yeah, anyone writing them down?
Anyway. And as I said, because they're hungry, they're raving, they're shaking their fists at the king and at God. Wherever they look,
that's right.
Wherever they go, there'll be trouble and anguish and dark despair, and they will be thrust out into the
driven into darkness. Yeah.
Now, what does that remind you of? What is this darkness he's talking? You know, it's a metaphor for sure, certainly, but it is a metaphor. Remember how I said that the worst thing about hell is not necessarily because of any kind of torture or medieval idea that is full of sulfur and brimstone and fires and absence of light
completely.
But the absence of light. And why is there an absence of light? Because there's a separation from God, an eternal separation. No more going back. No more. You are in eternal darkness. And that is why the Lord Jesus used that metaphor, mm-hmm. that same metaphor, when he was talking about the parable of the king and the wedding, his son's wedding, and the I think it's in that one. Also in talking about the difference between those that serve him with a right heart, with the right spirit, who know him, who know the Lord, and the Lord knows them because they feed the hungry, they clothe the naked, they go and visit the sick, and those that are in prison. When did we do those, Lord? And he said, when you did this to the least of my brethren, these, you did it to me. Yeah. And of course, the opposite, Lord, didn't we do all these things in your name? He said, no, depart from me. I never knew you. Mm-hmm. Because you never did, you didn't do these other things that you were supposed to do if you were mine. And what does it say? And they were put into the outer darkness where there was weeping and gnashing of teeth. This darkness is exactly what's being talked about here. This darkness is separation from God. Hmm. This is the worst fate. We can't picture it. I don't think human beings can properly. And this is why I think the Lord Jesus talked about hell more often than he talked about heaven. As a hell, not only a place to be avoided, but there was a very good reason to be that it needs to be avoided. And like Anne said, this idea of a place of eternal darkness, and we get that through the Old Testament. We talked about Sheol, place of the dead, gloom and darkness. But this ultimate darkness comes, and I think this is what the book of Revelation refers to when it talks about the second death. This second death is the one where part of that second death, if I understand it correctly, this is my own interpretation. When we are those who are assigned to hell and have live in this in darkness, and God's light no longer touches them. While we live, God's light is amongst us, no matter whether you believe it, whether you believe in God or not, or you serve Him. We benefit and can sense God's light all around us. His presence. But once you're dead, once you don't have that, once it's just your soul, and your soul is cast into this outer darkness where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth, again, there will be some who will weep. There will be some who will regret and weep that they didn't. But the gnashing of teeth is more of a more like this.
Will be magnified, eh?
Be magnified.
And also I think, though, that this represents the Assyrian judgment, the darkness are the Assyrians that are coming.
Well, it could be. Well, we're going to talk about that in verse 9, but to finish my thought about the second death, those souls that are, remember, those souls that are in Hades and are separated from God and complete darkness, that whole hell and Hades and death, what happens to it? It gets thrown into the lake of fire.
Right. Hell and Hades.
Now, it gets thrown into the lake of fire, but is it destroyed by the lake of fire? Don't know, but that's the second death. So you've gone out of the frying pan into the fire, so to speak. Maybe that's where that expression comes from with this. Mm-hmm. With this. But Anne's right. And it's talking about eternal gloom for sure, but it's also talking about the coming of the Assyrians and the darkness that will come over the land and the coming of the Babylonians as well, 100 years later. So...
Revelation 16:11.
Anne's going to read 16:11, and we're going to pray.
They blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores, and did not repent of their deeds. The fifth angel poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast, and his kingdom became full of darkness, and they gnawed their tongues because of the pain.
And remember, there was
also... They blasphemed God of
heaven. Remember, there's also a plague of darkness in Egypt.
Yeah.
But the Israelites in Goshen still have the light. The darkness was all over Egypt except where God's people was. Mm-hmm. Something to remember, I'm sure. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks. Father, we thank you, Lord, as always, for this opportunity to look into your scriptures, and while we have the light, Lord, to see the pages illuminated with your light, Lord God. We thank you, Father, that we know you. We thank you, Father God, that you have sent your Son to die for us, Lord God, that we may not have to fear these things. We do not have to fear the darkness. We do not have to fear hell. We do not have to fear being engulfed by the enemies of God. But you are our strong tower, Lord God, our refuge, our sanctuary, Lord. You are our foundation and our rock, Father.
Hallelujah.
And Lord, in you, we have no fear. But we will rise up as Anne quoted. We will rise up on eagle's wings by your power. And Father, we see your power demonstrated to us, Lord, in these, the pages of scripture, in the times of Isaiah, in the times of the prophets, in the time of our Lord, and in our own times, Lord God. We see your power. See your power working amongst us, Lord. And we are thankful, Father, to be children of light, not children of the darkness, Lord. That we have not been set aside for the wrath of God, but we have been set aside, Lord, for your protection, for your salvation, Lord, for your redemption, that we might dwell forever in the house of God.
Hallelujah.
Lord, we thankful, Lord, we are very thankful that you have called us, and that you have called us by name into your light. And as long as you are in the light, Lord, we will walk and follow you as you are in the light.
Amen.
Because we know, Lord, the Lord Jesus said there will come a time that
there
will come a time when darkness will come, when night will come, and no man will be able to work, and that we are to work during the day. And I know, Lord, that means our lifetimes, while we can still experience your light on this earth. Because when we pass through the thresholds, the portals of death, Lord, for those that do not know you, Lord, your light will become dim and then dark. And great will be the darkness in them, as the Lord said. But Father, thank you. You've made us children of light, that we have nothing to fear. Father, I pray a mighty blessing upon all who are listening to our dear branches, Lord. Pray that you will bless them today, Father, that you will lead them and guide them in all the paths of righteousness, Lord God. And they will see you in all the things that they say and all the things that they do and all the things that they hear today. And Father, we give you thanks, Lord, for this flock, Lord, that you have put together, this fellowship, Lord, that you have fashioned together. And cords of love, cords of the Spirit, and understanding. Father, it's been such a blessing to us.
Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Because you are in the midst of us, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
And we thank you, Father God. We thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, dear branches.
Well, dear branches, thank you again for joining us today on another look into the book of Isaiah. Tomorrow, we're going to be, as I said, we're going to be chapter 9.
Yep.
And the one that we're, another one we're so familiar with at Christmas time. But we're going to see it in context of exactly what it's prophetic. And again, it's like, it's like the Emmanuel prophecy of chapter 7. It is going to be a now prophecy for then, and it'll be a not yet prophecy for the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ in Bethlehem.
Yes. Exciting stuff.
Exciting stuff indeed.
Well, we love you and have a blessed day, and bless someone today.
Bless
Go
someone
out and
today.
Be a blessing. Yeah.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
And something we haven't said for a while, remember.
He is the vine.
He is the, Jesus is the vine.
We are the branches.
We are the branches. And we are commanded to
bear fruit.
Bear much fruit much for fruit. Him. But unless we are in his vine, we can do
nothing. Sobering thought.
That's very sobering thought. Until we leave you with that, until tomorrow.
See you. Bye.